Welcome back, my friends. So here we are again. Thank you to everyone who's come and tried out my software. If you're new around here, I'm building something called CalVPN. It's a brand new kind of VPN and you can use it for free. It's a post-quantum VPN and it can actually protect you from quantum computers. And it's literally the first one of its kind. So you should come use it for free. It's pretty exciting. And if you want to follow my journey, come subscribe. I give updates all the time. We currently have over 400 users. And I really appreciate every single one of you guys. It means a lot to me. And then the last thing, you should come sign up for the Daily Dance email. I send out this email every single day and I break down the latest in science. And it's, you know, this really tidy, easy to read format. You can skim through it in 2 minutes, see what's happening in the world of science. And it makes it easy to keep up to date. You know, I add a little personal note every day and, you know, to begin with, and as well as some AI art. And I really enjoyed writing that. We have about 1,300 people opening it every single day, and they seem to be getting some value out of it. So you should come sign up for free and join the dance crew. That's pretty lame, but yeah. Make sure you guys subscribe and hit the bell notification so you get notified when the videos come out. And don't worry, there's heaps of Kurzgesagt videos left, so we'll be here a while.
The future of humanity seems insecure. Rapid climate change, political division, our greed and failings make it hard to look at our species with a lot of optimism, and so many people think our end is in sight. But humans have always thought they lived in the end times. Every generation assumes they're important enough to witness the apocalypse, and then life just goes on. This is a problem because it leads to short-term thinking and prevents us from creating the best world for ourselves and our descendants. What makes this worse is that we may actually be living at an extremely critical moment in human history. To understand why, let's look at the temporal window of humanity and ask, when will the last human be born? And how many people will there ever be? These sorts of estimates come with a lot of uncertainties, so please take them with a gigantic grain of salt.
Will do.
To get a sense of how many people there will be, let's see how many people have already lived. Modern humans arose some 200,000 years
ago. So speaking of sci-fi, I can actually give you a rough figure, because in 2001, Arthur C. Clarke's book, at the very start, he talks about how there's roughly been about 100 billion humans to have ever lived. And I bring this up because he mentions this fun little thing. You should go read the book. It's one of my favorite books. And at the start, he says, it's a bit of a strange coincidence, isn't it, that, you know, there's been roughly 100 billion humans to have ever lived, and there's roughly about 100 billion stars in our local, you know, region of the universe, the Milky Way. Like an odd, it's kind of odd that it's similar, right? And so he kind of imagines, you know, maybe when we die, we get our own little world in the heavens. It's a nice thought, you know, especially if you're a fearful being, and it kind of helps, you know, make it all feel nice. But you know, obviously it's probably not true.
Modern humans arose some 200,000 years ago. They were uniquely making tools, telling stories, thinking abstractly, planning and working together in large groups beyond their close family. Still, there were not that many of us. Surpluses of food were scarce, survival was hard, life expectancy was low. It took us 150,000 years to grow to a population of 2 million, and eventually led to the agricultural revolution, arguably the biggest change in our history. This.
I would probably argue with that. It could be, for sure. But I think if you went further back, there's probably bigger changes in terms of, you know, just sentience and consciousness. Like when we first started painting on caves, I've mentioned this in a few videos, but that change is pretty monumental. Like, why did we just start painting on caves out of nowhere? You know, what about writing? Actually, I think writing, 100%, not 100. As I just told you, nothing's, I don't know, hold on to anything 100%. But writing, I think, was probably the biggest change in the history of our species.
This was when our numbers really started growing. It took 10,000 more years to get to 300 million. But that increase was dwarfed by the Industrial Revolution. In 1800, there were a billion of us. The human population doubled in just 120 years, and then again in 50. Today, we number around 8 billion. In total, over the last 200,000 years, about 117 billion humans were born and lived, and 109 billion also died. Which means that about 7% of all humans that ever lived are alive right now. As many as were born in the first 150,000 years of human history. Every minute, 270 babies join the party. But there aren't just more people. Never before have we been as healthy and well off, or lived longer. With growing living standards, our birth rates collapsed. The UN estimates that around the year 2100, we will hit our population peak.
We're getting into all that stuff Elon's been, you know, going on about for a while now. We'll talk about it if he keeps going.
And there will be 125 million people born each year. It's pretty unlikely that birth rates will stay stable forever, but let's pretend to make our thought experiment simpler. How many people there will be in the future depends on when our species will die out. And here, we find a lot of uncertainties. We are able to destroy ourselves through our own inventions, but we are also able to find solutions to avert catastrophes.
Just from watching this, you guys probably seen what happened with DART very recently, how we shot, you know, something at an asteroid to see if we could divert its path. How cool was that, by the way? And it actually, we made a bigger impact on the thing than we thought we would. And you can, maybe I'll put the photo up, I could forget, but there's a photo. Photos of the actual asteroid, what was it called? Dimorphos or something. And there's a huge chunk missing out of it. So awesome. It's like that movie Armageddon in real life. I grew up watching that movie. I actually went to a re-release the other week to see it. It's still just as good. There's so many inconsistencies and just incorrect things in that movie, but it's so awesome. I think between the ages of like 5 and 10, I probably watched it about 50 times, and I forced my younger brother to sit through it with me every time.
Catastrophic risk. We can change the direction of planet killer asteroids, but we've also invented nuclear weapons. We discovered antibiotics, but also carry diseases across the globe in a matter of days. Our industrial system gives us an incredible standard of living, but also changed the atmosphere in the process.
I think it's really important to, you know, also, I didn't mention it before, I was going to, but I don't want to talk too long every time I pause it. You know, the invention of things that really change the world all really do come through physics. You can trace everything in our modern world back to an invention, a discovery in physics, in fundamental science. And it's fundamentally true. A very easy way to demonstrate this is you can trace everything back in terms of technology to Faraday or Maxwell, electromagnetism, electricity, magnetism. Without an understanding of these things, there's no technology. And at the frontier of technology and our understanding, it's still in physics. You know, you've got quantum computers coming around, and you've got Cal now, the thing that I've built for you guys you can use for free, that can, you know, help protect you guys. But quantum computers could be on this list one day as, you know, maybe one of the more important things that happened to our world. The computer, 100%, should be on the list somewhere. But quantum computers could provide another monumental jump ahead, you know, even maybe even a larger paradigm shift to, you know, just normal computers. And that might be hard to believe right now, but just from thinking about what they could potentially change and have an impact on, it could be really big. Anyway, we're deep in a tangent. I can't even remember how we started this. That's right, physics. It all comes back to physics. Yes, so go study physics. Not because, you know, you have to or anything, just because, you know, if you feel like there's no magic in this world, you should just go study physics, because it'll reveal to you that everything is actually magic. And you might get the sense from listening to physicists or scientists that science is about sort of like degrading the magic of the universe, taking away. But it does the opposite. It actually proves to you that the universe is magic. So I've always loved that about physics, and it's very contrary to, you know, what everyone tends to think, which it's very hard to understand sometimes, but humans are complex. Anyway.
We could conceivably stick around for a long time. So every day we don't destroy ourselves may mean life for an unfathomable number of humans. How many people are we talking about? It depends on how far our species is going to expand. Scenario 1. Humans will never leave Earth. If we stay on our home planet, a good metric to look at is the extinction rate of animals that we get from the fossil record.
Oh dear, it's not
the
good.
Average life.
I can talk about this because before physics, I was going to go into wildlife conservation. I think protecting biodiversity is extremely important. And I wasn't a huge fan of humanity when I was younger. Come around, don't worry. So yeah, the background rate of extinction is what we call it. You know, that's from looking at the fossil record. And you have to also keep in mind that we can't see everything that ever lived. Not everything is in the fossil record, because not everything, you know, fossilizes. And so there's a lot of stuff missing from the fossil record. And so we really don't know what the background rate of extinction is, but, you know, it gives us a lower limit at least. And so from that, you can now gauge to present day, and we can look at how many species are going extinct every 24 hours, and it's actually about 1,000 times higher than, you know, the background rate of extinction, which is what it would be if humans weren't around. So that, you know, a lot of that could be from the stuff we're missing in the fossil, because the fossil record doesn't show everything, but it could just be that humans are really destroying everything, and that's what it kind of seems like, because yeah, there's a lot. There's something like 127 species of wildlife and animals go extinct every 24 hours. That sounds significant, right? Keep in mind, a lot of those things are beetles. It's something like for one in three species of animal and plant on the planet, it's a beetle. So there's a whole hell of a lot of beetles around. It's planet of the beetles.
Lifespan of mammalian species is in the region of 1 million years, with some surviving up to 10 million years. Our close relative Homo survived for about 1.9 million years. Let's be conservative. Humans will survive for a million years, which leaves us 800,000 more years to dawdle away. Assuming a stable birth rate of 125 million people each year, this means there are roughly 100 trillion humans waiting to be born. 850 times greater than the number of people that...
So we should say this is being very optimistic, all right? Also, if you can hear the dog barking, he's outside because he's been a bad boy. He ate one of my AirPods. Little punk. So he'll be back.
...ever lived. This would make everybody alive today only 0.008% of all people that will ever live. Think about where this leaves you. Instead of putting you at the end of the chaotic mess that was our past, it would mean you live at the very beginning of something big. The start of the human story rather than the end. Doesn't this...
So we should mention here, I'm not sure if he's gonna do it, but 100 trillion is a lot. So that, you know, obviously assumes we reach out beyond our own planet, because Earth has something called a carrying capacity, which is kind of like the absolute limit, theoretical limit of, you know, how many humans you could put on Earth and it's still sustainable without, you know, some kind of collapse, whether it's, you know, runaway greenhouse effect or we just completely run out of resources. And that's, you know, currently a possibility.
Feel incredibly different. And now, consider that this may be an extremely pessimistic estimate. If we match the survival time of the most successful mammals, then our future numbers rise to 1.2 quadrillion people that have yet to be born. And even this seems far from our potential. As the sun slowly gets hotter and brighter, Earth will remain habitable for about 500 million years, giving so many more potential people the chance to become actual people.
If you're wondering why it won't be habitable anymore, is because basically the sun is getting bigger and hotter, and it's gonna boil our oceans away. They will literally evaporate. So, you know, that's not gonna be a very fun place to be without beaches.
And think big. Scenario two, humans will leave Earth. We went from humans worshipping the moon to humans walking on it. So who knows how much further we can go. If we don't die out within the next few hundred, ideas that seem outlandish right now become serious considerations. If we believe that we have a chance of surviving for maybe millions of years, then we could expand onto the other planets or into our own artificial worlds. Life needs three things: a surface, resources, and energy. Material floating in the asteroid and Kuiper belt that we could sustain many times our current population. Instead of living on planets, we could decide to construct our own artificial worlds and habitats. With resources and energy so abundant, we could try out different types of society and ways of life. An interconnected civilization spanning the solar system would create the basis of existence for an absurd number of individuals, orders of magnitude more than if we stick to Earth, even if we only existed for a few million years. This future doesn't have to be grim and dark as science fiction likes to paint it. With quadrillions of people waiting to be born, we will have billions of doctors work.
That was horrific. That was like full horror. But let's not talk about that. We'll get to that in other videos, I'm sure. But
working on curing cancer.
We're just going to stick with optimism today. Optimism.
Billions of problem solvers working on ending poverty, and billions of video game developers making life fun. More humans may actually mean more progress. Another upside of leaving Earth and spreading out is that it becomes much harder for us to become extinct, as you need a solar system-wide catastrophe to catch everybody. So aside from nearby supernovae or gamma-ray bursts, humanity would be relatively safe.
There's actually far more common things that could happen rather than, you know, a gamma-ray burst or a nearby hypernova or something. And we've done this, you know, that video, what would happen if a star came near our star system? It would be very bad. And yeah, it could wreak havoc and eject, you know, some of the outer planets or Mercury, I mean. That would be pretty bad.
Extinction, maybe for billions.
A black hole could fly into our solar system unknowingly. They're pretty hard to see.
Years. If we manage to survive for that long, slow evolution or genetic engineering might split us into multiple species, or we might intentionally keep ourselves the same as we are now. So to account for that, we'll just talk about people from now on, instead of humans. Okay, now let's think really big. Scenario 3, people leave the solar system. As enormous as the solar system is, it is just one star system among billions in the Milky Way. If future people can colonize, say, 100 billion stars and live there for 10 billion years, with each generating 100 million births per year, then we can expect something like 100 octillion lives to be lived in the future. This is a one with 29 zeros, 100,000 trillion trillion. We can spin this up as much as we like. The Andromeda Galaxy will merge with the Milky Way, adding another trillion stars for us to settle. Red dwarfs stay active for up to a trillion years.
At this point, we're really contributing to the heat death of the universe. That is a lot of... that's a lot of...
And future civilizations might even find energy for their habitats around black holes. A sufficiently advanced civilization of our descendants might even try to reach other galaxy groups. While these numbers are mind-blowing, they may underestimate the number of unborn people by many...
Videos like this, don't they just want to make you live forever? Like, look at all this stuff we're gonna miss. I don't know about you guys, but it bloody sucks.
Orders of magnitude. If we divide the total energy available in a galaxy by the average energy needs of a single person, then we get a tridecillion potential lives. A million, trillion, trillion, trillion potential people. Conclusion. Hopefully, what's become evident is that
if we
don't kill ourselves in the next few centuries or millennia, almost all humans that will ever exist will live in the future. Which brings us back to us in the present. We exist at a high point in human history, with incredible possibilities at our grasp. Technological, environmental, and societal. What we do matters for all the people who do not exist yet. So while it's not en vogue to think about humanity's long-term future with optimism, or to think about it at all, maybe this has given you a bit of perspective. If we screw up the present, so many people may never come to exist. Quadrillions of unborn humans are at our mercy. Even if we go with fairly conservative estimates, the unborn are by far the largest group of people and the most disenfranchised. Somebody who might be born in 1,000 or even 1,000,000 years deeply depends on us today for their existence. This is why it's important to think about the distant future and why our presence is so crucial, why it matters what we do today. One day, the last human will be born. We don't know when. But if we change our perspective from us living at the end of the human story to us living at the very beginning, we can not only build a wonderful world for us and for them, but also for countless numbers of others. Huge.
Another beautiful video by Kurzi Kazar. And if you're feeling sad about, you know, not getting to see all of this future, that's why you should go read sci-fi or watch sci-fi. It allows you to live out, you know, the future of what could happen. But anyway, that'll do for today's video, guys. I hope you enjoyed. Make sure you subscribe. Come check out CalVPN. You can use it for free. I'll catch you in the next one.